John Michelle, where is the this thing?
Push.
On.
No, no.
Hello.
Everything's okay?
Tula slide is there.
Go, 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 clear. Just mute your audio.
Just a moment.
Go, 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 we're still there. Any problem. So, Ata, me just ek video run karte. You can now stop sharing your slide. Me ek तुझा ई बॅनर डिस्प्ले करेल कॉलेजचे व्हिडिओज शेअर करेल थोडं माझ्याकडनं शेअरिंग होईल वेन देन आय गिव्ह यू चार्ज आय से ओव्हर टू यू देन यू स्टार्ट युअर प्रेझेंटेशन शेअरिंग ओके ओके यू स्टॉप इट आय नीड टू इंट्रोड्यूस यू फर्स्ट अँड देन विल गो फॉर फर्स्ट इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ कॉलेज देन इंट्रोडक्शन टू यू अँड देन आय हँड ओव्हर इट टू यू Welcome to all the participants. We are still waiting for, there are 7 more minutes to go. So other participants can join as per the time was given, 5 p.m. IST. good evening to all the participants. Kindly give us a check whether we are audible to you, whether the audio is clear from our end. Please give a check in the chat box. You can post in the chat box whether the audio is clear or not. I, Fire Mrunal Patil, Assistant Professor, H.R. Patil Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Shirpur, welcome you all to this international webinar on the topic Antimicrobial Agents and Adjuvants, How to Test and Elucidate Their Mode of Action by Dr. Mrunal Patil. This webinar will be helpful for those who want to work in this area as it will unfold various important aspects of antimicrobial agents and their adjuvants. Also, it will help the participants to understand various methods of testing these antimicrobial agents and elucidation of mode of action of these agents. With this brief introduction about today's webinar, I now invite Dr. S.B. Bari sir, Principal, H.R. Patil Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Shirpur, to kindly welcome our speaker, Dr. Mrunal Patil.
Hello.
So unmute yourself, please, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Good evening to all. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yeah, you are audible.
Good evening to all. On the behalf of Shirpur Education Society's H.R. Patil Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, welcomes today's resource person, Dr. Mrunal Patil from France, as well as across all the world, all the participants. Our HR Piper is a reputed pharma institution in Maharashtra. Our institution is ranked NBA accredited, NIRF ranked institutions, and we have been organizing such international webinars. And I'm sure all these participants will get benefited by listening to Dr. Mrunal Patil. We will feel proud to say she is our alumni member. And I welcome again Dr. Mrunal Patil. Can you proceed? Seminar. Thank you very much.
Very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Now it's my privilege to introduce to you all our today's speaker, who is also alumni of our college, Dr. Mrunal Patil. Dr. Mrunal Patil, M.Pharm PhD, is currently Amidex postdoctoral researcher in section of membrane and therapeutic targets at Faculty of Pharmacy, Aix-Marseille University at Marseille, France. She started her journey from H.R. Patil Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research. She did her B.Pharm from our college. Then she pursued her M.Pharm in pharmaceutics. She was university topper during her M.Pharm. She pursued her M.Pharm from R.C. Patel Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Shirpur. Her topic of research was formulation and evaluation of amphotericin B nano emulsion loaded gel under the guidance of Professor Veena Balgambar. She did diploma in patent law with 6th rank from Nalsar University, Hyderabad, India. She was Newton Bhabha Fellow, where she joined School of Life Science, University of Nottinghamshire, UK. where her research topic was mechanistic elucidation of synthesized nanocarrier for antifungal activity under the guidance of Professor Simon Avery. She did her PhD from Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, Maharashtra. Her research topic was formulation and evaluation of nanocarriers for infectious disease under the guidance of Professor P.R. Babia. Her current research topic is synthesis and antibacterial evaluation of ionic liquids for overcoming antibacterial resistance, nanodiagnostic agents for antimicrobial efflux mechanism. Her area of research is lipid-based and self-assembled nano-drug delivery systems, antimicrobial resistance, and drug adjuvant combination therapy for antimicrobial resistance. Her professional experience includes an internship at Mylan Pharmaceutical. She had worked as assistant professor at R.C. Patel Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research Shirpur for 1 year. She was a Newton Bhabha Fellow at a PhD exchange program at Faculty of Medicine and Health Science, University of Nottingham, Nottinghamshire, UK, where she worked under Dr. Simon Avery. She has received various fellowships and fundings, which includes a JRA for her Master of Pharmacy for 2 years from MHRD, Government of India. She received, during her PhD tenure, she received BST Inspire Fellowship from BST, Government of India. She had received 2 travel grants. One is from ICMR and second is from CSIR. And she also received a Newton Bhabha Short-Term PhD Placement Fellowship, which she went for to pursue in UK. She has a number of achievements and awards to her name. She received a second prize at Avalanche National Level Competition at Gujarat. She was first prize winner at Converges at RCPIT. She had qualified GPAT in 2010. She is a first ranker in M-Pharm at NMU, Jalgaon. She received second prize in Best India 2014 competition, which was under Entrepreneurship Development Workshop. She received first prize at Bio India, Biotechnological Lead Enterprises. She was awarded a unique designer at IIT Gandhinagar. She participated in Novartis Biotechnological Leadership Camp at Hyderabad in 2016. She has 3 papers to her name, which are in 3 international publications. There is 1 patent which is under examination, which she filed in 2018. She has 6 conference abstracts. Her poster and oral presentation includes about 3 oral and poster presentation that she had presented at different places like USA, UK, and Portugal. So this is in brief about Dr. Mrunal Patil. So I'm with this brief introduction about Dr. Mrunal Patil. Now I'll ask Dr. Mrunal Patil to take the charge of this meeting and to start with her presentation. Over to you, Mrunal.
Hello. I am not able to hear your voice and pe nahi hai, mine is active. Okay. Okay, fine. Good evening, everyone. My name is Mrunal Patil. Today I'm going to talk about antimicrobial agent and adjuvants, how to test them and evaluate their mode of action. Briefly, my background, I belong to pharmaceutical background, but now I usually do a lot of microbiological testing and testing with the adjuvants and the antimicrobial agents. So before beginning towards this presentation, what you can expect from this presentation is the methodologies of testing and a glimpse at how mode of action is to be predicted. So I'll start with the basic. What are antimicrobial agents? Any agent, any natural or synthetic agent which has the ability to destroy or inhibit microorganism is called as antimicrobial agent. General classification, this is just the basic classification of antimicrobial agent. First is depending on what they are fighting. So if they are fighting the bacteria, they are classified as antibacterials. Example of this class is penicillin for staphylococcus and streptococci infection. Next is if they are fighting fungus, they are called as antifungal agents. Example in this category is fluconazole, amphotericin B. They fight candidiasis, aspergillus. Next category is antiviral, acyclovir for viral azoster, chickenpox. Next is antiparasite, benzenidazole for Tryptomonas cruzi infection, which happens in Chagas disease. There are many, these are basic four classification. Now the next classification is on how are they fighting? That is, what is the intensity of fighting? Are they static or are they sidle? So static means the microorganism will grow, will not multiply, but they will still be alive. That means you're not killing them, but you're stopping them to multiply. The drugs under this categories are chloramphenicol, clotrimazole. The next is sidle. Sidle is they kill the bacteria or the fungus, or the microorganism in general. They completely kill the microorganism. So these drugs are terbinafine, vancomycin, you have another class which is narrow spectrum or broad spectrum. These are the class how many can they fight. Now there are some agents which are universal, they can fight a lot of things together. There are some agents which are only specific to one kind of microorganism. For example, penicillin is narrow spectrum. The penicillin basically only fight against gram positive. They are not much effective against gram negative. So they are narrow spectrum antimicrobial agent. Broad spectrum is tetracycline. They can fight a lot of type of gram positive as well as gram negative bacteria. So depending upon how many can they fight, they can be classified as narrow or broad spectrum antimicrobial agents. Now, the most asked question is, what is the difference between antibiotic and antimicrobial? You can often see people confused between these two terms, antibiotic and antimicrobial. Are they same? Well, no, they are not the same. Antibiotic generally means opposing life. But in literal sense, if you see in medical terms, antibiotic is basically an agent which is produced by one microorganism against another microorganism. Penicillin G is the best example of this. So the other which are not produced by microorganism, they fall under non-antibiotic or antibacterials. So these together in combination becomes antimicrobial therapy. But antimicrobial therapy is a huge term. You have antifungals, antiparasites in them. So a fact check, antibiotics are mostly active against bacterial infection only. In some cases, fungal, like amphotericin B. Amphotericin B is also produced by a microorganism and it is active against the fungal species. But for most of the cases, they are active against bacterial infection. They are not active against virus. So I can say that all antibiotics are antimicrobial, but all antimicrobials are not antibiotic. So do not get mixed up with this term antibiotic and antimicrobials. Now let's proceed to our actual topic, that is antimicrobial versus the adjuvants. So these are two terms, antimicrobial agents and adjuvants. Now, what are antimicrobial agents? These are active compounds, and antimicrobial adjuvants, I would just say adjuvants, they may or may not be active, or basically they have less activity, or they do not have pronounced activity. So they can be drug or they can be non-drug. They can be salts, metals, copper, for example. Copper is an adjuvant. Then some lipids, rhamnolipids, they are adjuvants. Some of the salts, boric acid, they are adjuvants. So next is antimicrobial drugs. They have specific targets, whereas adjuvants, they may or may not have specific targets, but they have two mode of actions. One, they can directly act on the pathogen. That means they can either fluidize their cell walls, cell membrane, they can block the efflux pump, but no direct targets. So the next is either they can act on pathogen or they can act on the host. That means the person who has got the infection or the subject that has got the infection. So what it does is boost the immune response of the body to fight the microorganism. So you can see the adjuvants are something which are not given alone. They are always given with antimicrobial drug to enhance their activity. So drugs can be given alone, but if given alone, some of the drugs, you know, they hit a target site. And if there is modification at target site, there is a chance of antimicrobial resistance. And adjuvants are those agents which are given in combination with antimicrobial drugs to fight this resistance. Now, I'm putting up a image which actually explains what kind of, this is, there are many type of resistance. This is just few basic and important resistant mechanism that we see. One is drug is effluxed out of the cells. So if you have microbial cells, drug usually go out of the cells. They are just thrown out of the cell so that they do not reach the internal mechanism of the cell and the cells are not destroyed. So efflux pump is one of the antimicrobial resistance mechanism. The other mechanism is, as I told, there is modification in the target. Suppose there is a drug which binds a protein, a specific protein in the bacterial cells. And if there is a modification in that target, you don't get the activity. Modification can be by genetic means or by stress-induced modification. So in such cases, the microorganism may not respond to your drug because the target has been changed. So there are some targets which is linked to enzyme activity. There are some because of the membrane. Like in most of the yeast cells, the target is usually the cell membrane. So cell membrane can, you know, they can increase or decrease according to the stress responses. There are many microorganisms that has the ability to cover themselves in a shield, which is called as biofilms. I have not enlisted here, but some of the microorganisms, they just enwrap themselves into a blanket. So these are a type of resistance. And if the normal drugs, they are hitting a target and these all block them from actually hitting the target. So in this cases, you can use adjuvant in combination with the existing antimicrobial agents to combat resistance. And why I'm stressing upon adjuvant is because we all know that to bring a drug in the market it's very expensive. It roundabout takes more than 15 years to get a drug to a market. So in this crisis where we are facing antimicrobial resistance, it is difficult to find a new drug. Rather, what you can do is to improve the existing drug. So you use any adjuvant which actually potentiate or increase the activity of your antimicrobial agent. For example, I would say amoxicillin. Everybody know amoxiclav. Amoxiclav is combination of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. So amoxicillin, usually there is an enzyme called as beta-lactamase. So this amoxicillin is destroyed by beta-lactamase. So most of the drugs now, they gain resistance because of it. So we came up with giving clavulanic acid to destroy this beta-lactamase, and amoxicillin and clavulanic acid is now used for many kind of bacterias. So you can see that before it was not permeating inside, it was not acting because it was destroyed by beta-lactamase. But if you put clavulanic acid, it can destroy the cell wall formation, and hence you can destroy the microbe. A similar example is ciprofloxacin. Ciprofloxacin is a drug which is used in a urinary tract infection. You can see, usually this drug is known to have efflux, is a substrate of efflux pump. That means those organisms which have mutated to have more efflux pumps, they will throw out the ciprofloxacin from the body. And then the cell, the microbial cell, will be protected because no ciprofloxacin will go inside. So instead of going to find more ciprofloxacin kind of molecules, people combine ciprofloxacin with omeprazole, verapamil, such drug. Omeprazole, proton inhibitor, we all know. So these pump inhibitors, they actually go to the pump site and they inhibit them. And you see now the ciprofloxacin can enter the body of microorganism and they can destroy. So in this case, clavulanic acid, verapamil, omeprazole, they are all adjuvants. And the drugs is amoxicillin, ciprofloxacin. So now when you're clear with this, we can move forward. How to proceed with antimicrobial susceptibility testing. Now I'm using a short form AST, which is a well-known short form for antimicrobial testing. So in my further slides, you may get to hear AST. AST means antimicrobial susceptibility testing. So how do you proceed with testing? Suppose you have a new compound. So how should you go with the testing? So the first is know your drug or molecule. You should always know the drug or the molecule that you are going to test. When I say know your molecule, means you should know the physical property of the drug, physicochemical property of the drug. You should know if they are pH sensitive, because many microorganisms, when you're testing, the drug is in contact with the microorganism. So if the microorganism is changing the pH of the medium that is to be tested, like some of the microorganisms, they secrete lactic acid. So it changes the pH of the medium. There, if your drug is destroyed or they are degraded, then you cannot see the activity. So it's very important to know the physicochemical properties of your drug. Then whether they are thermosensitive or not. Some of the microorganism needs different temperature of incubation. It's not always 35 degrees Celsius or 37. Sometimes it has to be more. So in some cases, you have to check thermosensitivity of the drug. The most important part and the part that usually people neglect is solubility of the drug. Every antimicrobial testing, every compound that you test should be first tested for its solubility. Why? First, if it's hydrophilic or soluble compounds, it's usually good to go because most of the media are water-based. So they easily miscibilize in water and you can directly test them. So if it's hydrophilic water-soluble compound, it's good. But not necessary that all drugs are water-soluble. Most of the drugs, lipids, they are hydrophobic. Some of the plant extract, essential oils, they are all lipidic in nature. So they may or may not miscibilize in water. And at such condition, you can find yourself in flux where you cannot test the antimicrobial activity of the drug. So what do you do in such condition is you use solvent. Now you cannot randomly use any solvent. Basic, the standard solvent which is approved is DMSO. And that too, DMSO, you should use equal to or less than 1 microgram per ml. So you cannot use more of DMSO because DMSO itself is toxic. But in case if you have to use more of DMSO, make sure that you always put a solvent control. The next is for essential oils and lipid. Essential oils like basil oil, then rosemary oil, lavender oil. If you want to test these oils, if such oils have antimicrobial activity, they are not soluble in the media. What you can use is you can use twin 80 at 0.1 or 0.01 concentration, and then try to emulsify them and test them as it is. Make sure that the combination with the media and twin and your essential oil or lipid is clear. If it's not clear, then you might struggle in getting the MIC because turbidity will be misinterpreted as non-MIC point. So it is very important that you use surfactants. Some other surfactants like cremophore can be used. It's not reported, but you can use, but make sure that you have controls for the same. Then the next thing is you should always test saturation solubility of your compounds. For example, I can give is amphotericin B. Amphotericin B, if you make a huge stock solution, say 10,000 ppm, and then dilute directly to 10 micrograms per ml, you can see a precipitation of amphotericin B. So in such cases, you should slowly reduce DMSO concentration. From 10,000, you can go to 5,000, 3,000, 2,000, and then slowly even reduce the DMSO concentration so that you don't get a sudden precipitation. So always make sure that even if you're using DMSO for solubilization, you should gradually reduce the DMSO concentration so that there is not sudden precipitation. The next is, I know many of the people who are from a pharma cognosy background, they have extract of plants, and such extracts usually have solvent inbuilt them. Sometimes these solvents are evaporable in nature, some are not. So in such cases, you go by a method called as disc diffusion. So what is disc diffusion? I'll let you know further. But in this case, you adsorb the solvent on a filter paper or a paper disc, which is made up of Wattman filter paper 1 or 3. And then you place it on an agar to check its zone of inhibition. So the next thing to do is check for experimental protocol. Now you know about your drug, your molecule. The next thing is, how are you going to do the test? So how are you going to do the test? People usually refer papers as a reference, but I recommend that you use standard guidelines. There are these number of standard guidelines. I guess there are 8 standard guidelines for testing antimicrobial activity, but the most widely used is CLSI, that is Clinical Laboratory Standard Institute, and EUCAST, that is European Committee on Antimicrobial Susceptibility Testing. Now these are widely used. These two are widely used, and preferentially people go for CLSI because they have standard for microbes that are originated from animal. Also, they have interpretive criteria. So make sure that you read these guidelines. These guidelines are available on internet. And I am enlisting few of the guidelines. You can put these, just type CLSI and this codes, and you can get the whole guideline. Some of the guidelines are paid, but I guess it's a nominal $6 or $5 guideline book. You can buy it on internet, and do try and follow these guidelines because they give you a sense of repeatability and they have standards so that you can match your results. The next is, since many of the people don't know about these guidelines, I would like to highlight what these guidelines have in them. First, they have media supplement that is to be used for a particular microorganism. different microorganism requires different medias. So these guidelines have set of information that what kind of supplement should you be using for a particular microorganism. Like you have fastidious microorganism, which fastidious means they are difficult to grow. They don't grow in normal media. So you need some special nutrients for them to grow. So these guidelines have how much amount of the nutrient is needed and what nutrient is needed for a specific bacteria to grow. So you can refer these guidelines and get them. The next is technique of solubilization. Now I was saying stock preparation. When you're testing, how do you prepare the stock? So I have this snapshot from M27A2 guideline. This is a guideline for yeast. When I did my PhD in Candida infection, so I referred this guideline, and you can see this guideline give you how to prepare the dilution for water soluble drugs as well as water insoluble drugs. So you can follow these guidelines and you can determine how to dilute and how much to dilute and what concentrations to prepare. A close look, the final concentration, you can see the final concentration is 64, 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, 1. Usually we don't start from 1000, then 500, 250. We usually take 64, 32, 16, 8, 4 as standard because it gives you a whole number. So you don't have more of points in your testing. So it's better to start from 128, 64, 32, 16. So I'll tell you in my next upcoming slides why to do so. Then more in these guidelines, you can find how much of bacteria should you put for testing. You cannot just randomly take any bacteria, put it into the media and just culture it and then test. You have to have a concentration of bacteria. So if it is more in number, probably you won't get the exact MIC. If it's less in number, probably you may get the MIC, which is very low. So there has to be a standard how much bacteria you should put for your testing. So this guidelines will give you everything from how to make media to how to make the inoculum and how to interpret the result. Now let's talk about how to interpret the results. Now this guidelines will give you quality control standards. We all have to follow, there has to be something to have as a quality control standard. So for example, if you're preparing a cookie at your home, so you try to match the recipe of your mother, right? And try to get as close as possible. So the similar way, these guidelines have a recipe and they have a control over their recipe. So this is how you test it. When you are following these guidelines, you try and use their quality control strains and reference standard and check the MIC along with your test products so that you know that your experiments are going right. If you find a deviation from this MIC range, that means something went wrong. Maybe the pH of the media was wrong, or maybe you use more of the culture, or maybe you use less of the culture. So this is how you find the quality control of your testing protocol. And this is how every time when you perform the test, you are sure that it's going right and your tests are repeatable. The next information that you get is the breakpoints. Now, breakpoints are important for those people who are not testing drug or adjuvants, but who are actually finding isolates. Doctors, some of the pharmacists who are involved in clinical research, they are finding for isolates, resistant isolates, susceptible isolate, dose-dependent isolates. Say I have Staphylococcus aureus. Now I want to know whether the Staphylococcus is methicillin resistant or susceptible. How do you go about it? I have a Candida isolate. I want to know if the Candida isolate is susceptible or it is resistant. So this guideline also give you breakpoints. You can see I've given a snapshot here. This says that fluconazole, if the MIC is less than 8 microgram per ml, it is susceptible. But if the MIC is falling between 16 to 32, it is dose dependent. If the MIC is more than 64, that means it is resistant. So this is how you come to know whether a microorganism is resistant or susceptible. So this is important for those people who are doing clinical research. So you can refer the CSLI guidelines for breakpoints. The next is know which method to adopt for testing. Now, the most important thing is I have my compound, but I don't know how to go about which method to adopt. Should I follow distance fusion? Should I follow dilution method? I don't know. So basically there are about six different methods reported. Some methods are diffusion oriented, dis diffusion and Stokes method, dilution oriented, micro dilution, macro dilution, agar dilution method. And there is diffusion plus dilution method, which is called as E-test. The first two are qualitative. The next two, the next are quantitative methods. But the most appreciated and the most reproducible method reported by CLSI guidelines is these three: dis diffusion, broad dilution, and agar dilution. So I'll be only talking about these three methods today, and they are the most widely used methods for testing antimicrobial susceptibility. The first is dis diffusion. It is also called as Kirby-Bowers diffusion method. So what do you do is first you grow a microbe overnight. This is a very important step. Everybody neglects this step. You should always have fresh microbes on your plate. That means if you are going to conduct the test today, it should be grown yesterday. So it is always fresh, and you have, you know, your microbes are fresh and they're not contaminated. So you should always have a microorganism which are at exponential phase and which are growing. They are not at the stage of death. So then you make a suspension. Now I told you that CSLI guidelines have methodologies to make suspension. So there are two methods to make suspension. One is you make it in a saline media, and then you compare it to 0.5 McFarland turbidity standard. Now, what is 0.5 McFarland turbidity standard? It is a solution of barium sulfate. So if you put barium sulfate in water, you can see that it has a certain amount of turbidity. So this is a standard. There is a procedure in CSLI how to prepare McFarland standard. But if you don't want to prepare it, you already get it in high media, Merck. They sell these standard. There is just a turbidity to the solution, and you can compare the turbidity of your microorganism solution to the McFarland standard, and then you can, if you match them together, you approximately have 150 million cells in your solution. And then you can dilute as per the protocol says. Now that I know that my 1 ml is having 150 million cells, I can dilute it as the protocol says, because different microorganism will have different cell concentration to be tested. So I cannot actually put any values here. The next is then you spread these inoculum on a petri dish. Make sure that you spread it from all the sides. The next method is you directly put the inoculum inside the agar and then pour the agar. The pouring method is known as pour plate method, and spreading method is called as spread plate method. The only difference is with spreading method, you have bacteria or fungus or microorganism, I mean specific, a microorganism that grow on the surface. And in pour plate method, you have microorganisms which are embedded inside the agar. So you can have tests both the ways. The next is after you prepare the plate, you either there is a dispensing unit by which you can dispense the antibiotic disc, or if you don't have this apparatus, what you can do is make the disc. You know, you can, discs are nothing but filter papers. They are small circular cuts from filter paper, and they are available in a lot of size. So you can put your sample on the disc, air dry them, and then put them on the petri dish. Make sure that they are in well contact with the agar, and then incubate them. The next thing is you measure the zone after a day, whatever the incubation time is. For some microorganism it's 2 days, some microorganism it's 1 day. So after the appropriate incubation, you measure the zone of inhibition. And then you take a scale and you read how many millimeters was the zone. Alternatively, there are other techniques, which is known as cork boring technique. It is also a disc diffusion technique. The only difference here is you don't have this filter paper disc. You have to instead create a well inside the agar. So you have this cork borer. They are available in many size, depending upon how much ml, sorry, not ml, but microliters. How much microliters you have to test, you can bore that much size of hole and then put your concentration inside the hole and then incubate. The other test is e-test. I'll go through this very short. It is new in comparison with the rest of tests. E-test, it has a strip. E-test is actually developed for known antimicrobial agents. So these are commercially available strips, and these strips has a gradient of concentration loaded on them, right? Starting from zero to the highest concentration of your antimicrobial agent. So you can just put it on the agar, which has already the inoculum, and then you can see. Here you can see that, you know, at this end, the concentration is highest. That's why you have a bigger zone, and then the concentration decreases. So the concentration where you just saw that there was inhibition, that is your MIC. So what if I'm having a plant extract? I told in my previous slides that if you have a plant extract, better go for disc diffusion studies. Now, if I have a plant extract, what I can do is, and if I know the concentration, I can put some of the plant extract on the disc and then allow it to dry. After it has dry, I can put it on the agar plate, which already has an inocula. Note here, the volume, the concentration of your compound is more important than the volume. Many people ask this question, should I put 10 microliter or should I put 20 microliter? Should I put 30 microliter? The volume is not important here. Important is what is the concentration of your extract. The concentration, you should check 5 to 6 different concentration of your the extract. Maybe And make sure that there has to be a thing that I want to say is it should be evaporable solvent that you're using. Many people, what they do is they have hexane extract and they put hexane extract on the disc and they put it on the agar plate and they see a zone. Basically, hexane is it's toxic. You cannot use hexane, and most of time it's an argument among the researchers, hexane is not acceptable. So in this case, what you can do is try and extract the compound out of hexane, try to alternatively dissolve it or precipitate it, and then maybe you can lyophilize the compounds and then test it, or maybe try to use different solvent. And if you're using hexane, then I think you have to dilute it into DMSO, or so into ethanol or something. You cannot actually use a non-evaporable solvent. That can be a misleading information. But if you have to, make sure you have, again, the solvent control. Data interpretation. You can use a normal scale or you can use vernier caliper in this context. The data can be represented in millimeters or centimeters. The point from which you actually don't see any growth, or you see a slight growth, zone, is demarcated as your zone of inhibition. Note, in this particular technique of disc diffusion, you should note that the most important criteria is diffusibility of your compounds. I know pharmaceutically people go for testing disc diffusion, adopt disc diffusion for gels, nano emulsions, and I guess for suspensions. But the most important factor you should consider is whether they are diffusible. Compounds which are absolutely not diffusible, they are not going to you know, penetrate the agar and show you any zone. So you can just misinterpret it as there is no activity, but there is activity. You can do an experiment. Take a drug called as miconazole. Miconazole is basically insoluble in water. You just suspend the miconazole and then try to put it on the disc and just see. There will be no zone. Miconazole is an active drug, but you can't see any zone because the drug was insoluble and it did not diffuse out into agar. So it is very important that you should have diffusibility of the compounds that you're going to test. So the barrier in this disc diffusion test is the compound should be diffusible. If they are not diffusible, you're not going to see a zone. The next important criteria here you have to consider is the inoculum size, the growth rate, the temperature, the environmental factor, and the media. While preparing media, I know the agar, many people, what they do is they don't buy an agar, they take the media and they put external agar to it. If your agar is very thick and it is very solid, you will have problems in diffusion. So follow the standard guidelines, follow the exact amount of agar which is to be added so that you have a basic gelatinous agar bed for diffusion. The next is temperature, environmental factor. Of course, they can inhibit the growth of microorganism. But the most important factor here is depth of the agar. I have seen people that they just prepare the agar in conical flask and pour inside the petri dish without even measuring it. Do not do this. Because if you are directly pouring the agar, you don't know if all my plates have the same amount of agar. So usually, what I do is I prepare agar separately. I take small conical flask and I have 20 ml of my agar solution in each conical flask. And then I put the whole 20 ml inside a standard petri dish. So you should make sure that if you are having comparative results or if you are trying to compare with the standard formulation or something, you should always make sure that you have the same thickness of the agar. Otherwise, your zone will vary. Even if you're doing it in repeatable studies, you will find a variation when you're having inter-data compilation. So make sure that the agar bed is of the same depth. Mostly it is 3 to 4 mm. The next is pH of the test. As I mentioned earlier, pH, there are some microorganisms that prepare lactic acid. They can vary the pH. And there can be degradation of your compounds. Also, inbuilt the pH, like some bacteria, they grow at acidic pH, the acidophilus bacteria especially. So you have to manipulate the pH of the media to exactly get to a point where you see a growth. Otherwise, you will not see a growth and then you will consider that, oh, the zone was so big that my plate is clear. So this can be a misinterpretation. The only advantage of this method, it is low cost and it is very easy to modify. The next is broad dilution. This is very important technique. Broad dilution, there are two types of broad dilution. One is macro and one is micro. Macro, usually the volume is 1 mL. And micro, the volume is less than 1 mL. Usually it's like 0.2 mL, 200 microliters or something. If your compound you have in abundance, you can go for macro broad dilution. So here you first prepare your test concentration. The test concentration that you prepare is twofold. That means if I need 64 micrograms per ml, I prepare 28. So it has to be twofold the concentration that you prepared. I'll tell you why. First, you prepare a stock solution. Maybe if the stock solution is in DMSO, then you need to dilute it. So make sure that the first primary stock is a larger one. And then you prepare the secondary stock. You have media, you have tubes, you can take test tubes. You have test tubes with 1 mL of your plain sterile media. Then you take 1 mL from your secondary stock, put it inside your first tube. Okay, so my first secondary stock was 256 ppm. When I put inside the first tube, which was already having 1 mL, now I have 1:1 dilution, matlab 50. Means 50-50 dilution. So 256 is now reduced to 128. And then from this, you take 1 mL, you put it in the other tube. So this technique is called serial dilution. So you see from 128, the concentration is now 64, 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, and so on. And the last one, that 1 ml, you pip it out and discard it. Now, all the tubes are having 1 ml with different concentrations in it. The next step, what you do is prepare inoculum. As I told you earlier, you either prepare inoculum by comparing it with McFarland standard. In this picture, you can see there is 0.5 of McFarland standard. And this is the cell suspension. And you just try and compare its turbidity. You usually check guidelines for what has to be your final concentration. You can alternatively use one more technique, which is called as a turbidometric assay or optical density reading. But for this, you should know the growth curve of the microorganism. If you know the growth curve of the microorganism, then you know 0.1 OD corresponds to how many cells, 1 OD corresponds to how many cells. And by N1 V1 is equal to N2 V2, you can calculate how much of dilution you should do. So the dilution, the inoculum that you prepare should also be into two. That means twofold the concentration. Say if you want to prepare 1 into 10 raised to 3 CFU per ml, sorry, if you want to prepare 0.5 into 10 raised to 3 CFU per ml, you go for preparing 1 into 10 raised to 3. Then what you do is add this inoculum into 1 ml of this inoculum into your test concentration that you prepared. Now, there was already 1 ml. Again, you added 1 ml of inoculum. Now, the total concentration in your tube is 2 ml. Again, there is 1:1 dilution. You can see my first concentration here in the preparation technique was 128. Now, it is 64. And that is why we prepared two-fold dilution. My desired concentration was 64. That's why I had to prepare 128 because 1 ml of inoculum was added. So finally, we have 2 ml of your cells plus the media and the concentration. The next thing that you do is incubate. But before incubation, you should note that you should have controls. Positive control, negative control, and solvent control. Positive control is the control where you will find the growth of cell normally without any antimicrobial agent or adjuvant. So you take 1 ml of sterile media and 1 ml of the prepared suspension that you added, cell suspension that you prepared, and you have 2 ml of your positive control. Negative control is the same way. You don't add drug, you don't add the cell, you just have plain media. What if your media was already contaminated, or maybe it had gone bad, or it had it was exposed to something because of which it got contaminated. So for this, you have to keep a negative control so that you have the calculation of zero. The next is solvent control. If you're using solvents like DMSO, or maybe you're using TWIN in some context, so you should always put solvent control. What I do is I use the highest amount of solvent, which is in my first dilution, and the lowest that I have in the last dilution. So I have two type of solvent control, but you can only start with the first one. It's okay. Then after incubation, you have your results. Now here you see in tube 4, 2, 1, you have growth, but the concentration, which was 8 micrograms per ml, you don't have growth. So this concentration, the first concentration where you don't find the growth, is called as MIC. Minimum inhibitory concentration. Minimum, that's why even 16, 32, 64 are inhibitory concentration, but this is the minimum value. So 8 is your minimum inhibitory concentration in this test. This is how a macro dilution test looks when you perform it in the lab. You can see at 8, the solution seems to be absolutely clear. So you can predict that there was a microbial growth in this and there was no growth in this. That's why this is your minimum inhibitory concentration. But is it actually inhibitory concentration? That means, do you think that all the cell present in 8 microgram per ml were destroyed? Maybe they did not grow. Maybe they were static, not cidal. it did not kill, but it did not allow the growth of the cells. How do you find it out? You have to plate it on the agar. Now what I do is I plate the concentrations on the agar. Maybe you can take just 20 microliter and spread it on the agar. And then incubate for one more day and then check. Now you see 8 was my MIC, but I still have 2 colonies growing on my petri. So this is MIC, but it is not MFC or MBC. That is minimum bactericidal or fungicidal if you're testing fungus concentration. So when I'm reporting in paper, I can say 8 was my minimum inhibitory concentration, whereas 16 is my minimum bactericidal concentration or fungicidal concentration, or whatever that you're testing. So don't be confused between these two terms. Inhibitory does not mean that it has killed all the microorganism. It just means that it does not allow the growth of microorganism. In some cases, MIC can be equal to MBC or MFC. In case of fungicidal drugs or bactericidal drugs, which readily kills microorganism, or maybe ethanol, they don't inhibit, they directly kill if you are using 70% ethanol. So you should note in this condition that the one more point that you should note is for MIC, it's not an absolute value. You know the value, you see this is double dilution. From 8 directly, you have tested 4. So the values actually lie between these points. And if you want to get the exact point, then you should try testing 16, 15, 14, all the points. But in case of reporting, yes, you can report this point as MIC, but do not consider it as an absolute value. The next is microbroth dilution. We tested macrobroth. The microbroth, I told you, just the difference is the volume of testing. There you can exceed from 1 ml to 2 ml, 3 ml. In microbroth, we use 96 well plate. So imagine that you have a compound which maybe you have synthesized or extracted, and you have very less amount of compound. You cannot afford to, you know, make larger dilutions. In this case, you use microbroth dilution. This is usually done in 96 well plate. And the total volume that you can test is 200 microliters. So the wells, these circles that you can see, these are actually wells. And then you can put your media, your cultures inside, as it was done for macrobroth. The same procedure, basically, just the volume is less. And then you can incubate and you can see. You can see the clearing zone I have marked with red. You can see it's a clear well here. The rest well are turbid. And then you can make out what was the MIC of your compound. Now, the major question that people ask is, whether should I report MIC 50 or should I report MIC 90? What do you mean? So MIC 50, MIC 90, there are a lot of meaning of MIC 50 and MIC 90. But the most anticipated meaning that people look out for is MIC 50 is 50% growth inhibition in comparison with the control. This is your control here. So if you know how much is your control, and if you compare that there was a 50% reduction in the optical density of your control, then you report it as 50% MIC or 90% MIC. But can you see it with naked eyes? No, you cannot see MIC 50, MIC 90 with naked eyes. There is absolutely no technique to see it naked eyes. So what you can do is you can use optical density readers, or you can use dyes. Now, there are some specialized dyes which can be used for reading these plates. There are tetrazoleum salts, MTT, XTT. These are the most famous dyes. And there is Risa's urine. I have given an example of Risa's urine. So if your cells are dead, the Risa's urine is, you get a blue color in your well. If they're alive, they exhibit pink color. So this is how you find the MIC, and then you can even read the fluorescence of this plate, and then you can find MIC 50, MIC 90 in comparison with your control. Also, you can use graphical representation. You can plot the growth of your microorganism versus the concentration, and then you can check where was your MIC50 lying. But according to me, there is no utmost need to report MIC50, MIC80, or MIC90, because not all the molecules that you test will give you MIC50, MIC90. The thing is, for some of the agents, the MIC is a sudden drop. That means you find a growth and in the next well, you don't find a growth. For some, it is a gradual decrease in the cell concentration. That means maybe the cell started inhibiting, then 50% got inhibited, then 40%, 60%, 70%. So not necessary that you will always find MIC50. So don't be under this impression that you will always get MIC50. The next is MIC50, MIC90 also has a different meaning. If you search this on internet, you can find Dr. Olivier. He said on his ResearchGate answer that usually MIC50, MIC90 is used by the clinicians, wherein a particular antimicrobial works for 50% of your isolate in a set of species. That means if I'm testing E. coli and I have to take 100 E. coli species, and if my XYZ drug is active on at least 50 of the E. coli that I have taken, then it's MIC50. Or if it is active against 90 of the E. coli that I have taken, then it's MIC90. So these two things can have different meanings. But I would suggest that you should report MIC and MFC or MBC, bactericidal and inhibitory concentration, rather than reporting MIC50 and 90 in your paper. The next is agar dilution method. This method is common to, it's similar to the broth method. Instead of broth, you have agar. You make different concentration of agar with your compounds, and then you pour it into a plate. And then you can just put 10 microliters of different bacteria on the plate, and you can incubate it, and then you can grow. You can see here with 4 microgram per ml, I had 3 type of bacteria growing. With 8 microorganism, I had 2 type of bacteria growing. It inhibited the green one, and here it inhibited the red and the green both. So this is how you can find MIC for different kind of bacteria. The advantage of this method is you can test a lot of bacteria or a lot of microorganism at the same time. Next thing is if you want to have, if you have like more than 1,000 bacteria or 1,000 fungal organisms, you can use replicators like this, and you can just put a little bit on your agar at the same time and you can get the results. So this is very fast method. But if you're not using any automated tool, it can be laborious because preparing agar takes a lot of time. Then the MIC is not always easy to read because there are some fastidious organisms and they may take time to grow in comparison with the normal organism. So it can be tricky in this context. So checkpoints for antimicrobial testing is check pH of your media, have quality control and reference strains. Solvent control is very necessary. And next is check for contamination. Then how to deal with combination therapy. Now you can see that maximum research is going on combination therapy, where you have drug A, drug B, and you have synergism, you have additive effect. So how do you actually test combination? Combination can be of 3 types: synergistic, antagonistic, and additive. Synergistic is 1 plus 1, 11. You have more than to expect. Antagonistic is where you have inhibition of the actual activity. Additive is you really don't see very big effect, but it's 1 plus 1, 2, just a little bit of addition. So preferentially, we prefer synergistic effect when we are looking for combination therapy. So how do you go about testing combination of a drug? So you prepare 2 stock solutions for compound A and compound B. Again, 4-fold of stock solution. In the previous method, you prepared 2-fold. Now you're making 4-fold. And then microbial suspension, which is only 2-fold. Then you take a micro 96-well plate. you add your compound A and compound B. Now, if you can see, compound A is horizontal, compound B is vertical, going vertical ways. So you add 50 microliter from each of the conversation that you have prepared and just put in each well. So 50 of compound A, 50 of compound B, 50 microliter from each. And you see there are different concentration that I have put. So in each well, different concentration of A, in each well, different concentration of B. And then together their combination. Make sure that you have one well with zero. That means for compound A, this particular row is zero. That means you have no compound A. And for compound for the H row, you have no compound B. So this is only to check MIC, because you need to have a set of wells where you don't have the other compound so that you know the MIC of the compound. Next is after you have done with adding the concentration A and B that you prepared, you add the microbial suspension. You add 100 microliter of microbial suspension. Now, I prepared two-fold microbial suspension because here you had 50 of A, 50 of B, that means 100. And now you have to just 1:1 dilute. That's why only two-fold dilution, whereas the concentration got four-fold diluted. And that's why I used 100 microliter of microbial suspension. So now total volume inside my plate in each well is 200 microliter of the media concentration and the microbial suspension. Now you incubate the plate. After incubation, you check for two different things. One, minimum inhibitory concentration of the drugs alone, drugs or the adjuvant. You should know, for us now the compound is A and B, so you should know the MIC alone for A and MIC alone for B. The second is MIC in combination. And then you use this formula, which is MIC of A in combination divided by MIC of A alone plus MIC of B in combination divided by MIC of B alone. Say this was our result. This is an example. This was our result. Now you can see here there was drug A. So the MIC. Now in this well, there is no drug B. You can see the drug B is zero. That means, and I have a clearance, I don't have any microorganism growing here. And this is its minimum inhibitory concentration. That means for drug A, the MIC was 8. Similarly, for drug B, the MIC was 10. Now, which concentration will you check for combination? Now, these are all growths, and the clear ones is where you don't have growth. So basically, check the concentration on border. I have marked it with yellow. Check the concentration of border. Say I take this particular point that I have marked with star. So at this particular point, this is MIC in combination. So here the concentration of A was 0.5 and MIC of A is 8. So 0.5 divided by 8. For B, the concentration is 4 and the MIC is 16. So 4 divided by 16. As per the formula. So you get FICI, that means fractional inhibitory index, which is 0.3125. Now, according to this experiment, the FIC value, if your FIC values are below 0.5 or equal to 4.5, you say that there is synergism. If the values align between 0.5 to 4, that means it's an additive or indifferent interaction. And if your FIC is more than 4, that means there is antagonism. Now there is one more thing to do, is you can plot isobolograms. Isobolograms is nothing but is actually a graph. What you do is you say EC50, or you take the half of your MIC and then you draw a line which is called as line of additivity. That means half of compound A, half of compound B becomes your line of additivity. And you calculate FICI for all these points, the one I have marked in yellow, and try to plot it on this graph. If the graph is going down the additive line, that means there is synergism. All the point that falls below the additive line is synergistic points, and those combination are synergistic. If there is a point which is lying above the point, then it is antagonistic. Most of time when you have synergism, you have some points which is lying very close to additive line. Do not consider such points because they are additive in nature. You basically plot a line where it is synergistic. Basically, when you plot a line, you ask for points which are way below the additive line. So here it's, you can do by two method. One is the FICI method, or you plot isobolograms. The best method is for FICI, and you can see FICI, many papers have reported FICI, and this is by far the most easiest method to do. The next is, what if my compound cannot be tested by broad dilution method? What if I cannot test for 96 well plate method? And if I have done it by agar diffusion method, don't worry. Agar diffusion method, you can also check for synergism, antagonism, and additivity. The zones that you get are like this. For synergism, you basically get a fused zone, and the zone are slightly bigger than the actual one. Antagonism, you can see the zone actually part away from each other. They, as if they are not looking at each other. And additivity, you have the zone merging, but you can see that they are not fused into each other. They are merging. They are not fused. And if there is indifferent interaction, they'll have their own zones. But for this experiment also, you should actually know what their initial zone is and try and place the disc at such a distance where you try and get a fusing zone. Okay, so the next method is time kill. So time kill is a method which is, you can use as a confirmatory method. What you do is you take media and you put half of the MIC A and half of the MIC of B individually and in combination. And then you try to plate it at different time points. Or you can even check turbidity of these flasks by putting them in 96 well plates. You can do, this is basically a kinetic assay. That means it is dependent upon time. At every, you can fix time interval according to you. Basically, you can just withdraw it at 4 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, and then you can plot a graph. You have to incubate the plate, and after a day, you plot a graph that at 4 hours, I got this much of cells. Basically, it's always log CFU, log to the base 10 CFU per ml. And you try and count how many microbes did you see. And you can see, you can get like this curve where you have a vehicle control, a growth control, compound A, compound B. Make sure that you're not adding MIC. If you add MIC, you'll kill all the cells. So you can see compound A, B, there was a huge decrease, whereas for A alone and B alone, there was not so much of decrease. So you can identify from this that yes, there was a synergism, but just by looking at the graph, you cannot make out how much is the synergism. So how you do it is, if you see more than 2 log CFU reduction in comparison with the most active compound. Now in this figure, we can see compound B was the most active. So if the difference between the line of compound B and your combination, you basically see it after 24 hours. But however, you can even check at the time, you can see a huge decrease or a steep decrease. It's no specific, but the IDLE guidelines say that you should check after 24 hours. If you see a huge decrease, and if the decrease is more than 2 log CFU, that means there is synergism. And if the decrease is more than 3 log CFU, that means there was a sidal action. So this technique is good. You can also find whether there was a sidal action. Also, you can find whether there was a synergism. If it is less than 2, then there is additive effect or antagonistic effect. Now, how to find mechanism of action? Now, this was, the previous slides were all about testing. Now, what if I want to find what is the mechanism of action of my compound? So if say any chemistry people or people from pharmacology, they have already in mind, okay, I want to extract something which inhibit the sterol synthesis in fungus. So they have a mind clear that they want to make an agent which is inhibiting sterol. Okay. Or maybe I have a drug which should inhibit XYZ protein. So they have in mind that I am targeting this protein. So people go for biochemical assay or computational assay. Computational assay, you prepare in computer, you prepare a grid of the of your molecule, and you prepare a grid of the protein, and you see the interaction of them. You find if there was what kind of interaction there was, what was the energy of interaction. But imagine that out of nowhere, you don't know anything, that what is the mode of action. You just have a random drug. I say I took atorvastatin, and I just want to know if atorvastatin is showing me a little bit activity on my bacteria, and I want to know what is the mechanism of action. How do you find in this case? Because you don't know where is your target action. So if you have some idea, if you have first hint, I would suggest go for biochemical assay or computational assay. If you don't have any idea, you go for gene deleted library screening. Now, what is gene deleted library screening? I know for most of people, this term is a bit big, because not many of people are aware about genetic engineering, or many of people, especially in pharma, we don't go through genetic modulations or genetic screenings. So I will first introduce to what are gene deleted libraries. So for this, I am taking an example of Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Saccharomyces cerevisiae is a yeast. Okay, and I have a compound called as XYZ. I want to check mechanism of XYZ on Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So I take a parent yeast. Parent yeast is like mother yeast, or you say the mother from which you make small babies, which are genetically modified. So I take a parent yeast. BY4743 is one of the parent yeast. And then there are some genes inside yeast. Okay, now in every cascade, you try and delete one gene. So maybe I deleted red gene. Triangle is a sign of deletion. So I deleted one gene. Now what I have from the parent yeast is a S. cerevisiae mutant, which doesn't have the red gene. So like this, there are a lot of non-essential genes which are deleted, and people create a library of such organism. So there are more than 4,000 of organisms, and these organisms are stored into a well. This is 364 well or 96 well plates. Nothing. They are just cultured, and then they are, you know, basically you use, can't explain this way, but you use these babies out of parent yeast wherein all mutants are deleted, and then you try and store it sequentially on a cryoplate. Now, every mutant is different. One mutant maybe has A gene deleted, the other mutant has B gene deleted. Now, what you do is first, when you have your plates ready, the first thing is you check the MIC of compound. I first go for normal testing by AST method, what I have done. Say the MIC of my compound was 16 microgram per ml. Then I choose a sub-inhibitory concentration. Sub-inhibitory concentration means it should not be MIC, it should be less than MIC. So 14, 12, 10, 8 is less than MIC. So I use this concentration to test. Now, replicate the library. Library that I created. Usually, you don't have to worry. These libraries are available commercially, so you can just buy this library, though they are very expensive. But you can, if your institute, you can buy this library and keep inside. And then you can, then whenever you want to use, just replicate these libraries. You cannot use it from the parent library. You just replicate in fresh medium. Use this pinning device. Nothing is, it's just like a pin. It's like a stamp. You just put it on the library that you have and just replicate in fresh media. Then the next is prepare agar plates. Now, prepare agar plates having sub-inhibitory MICs. Like I prepare agar plate with 14, 12, 10, 8 of XYZ concentration. Okay, my compound XYZ is used at these sub-inhibitory concentration. I prepare many plates. Then from this library that I created, I just punch them onto the agar. Okay, it's just like replicating. I just took inoculum from the library and I put it on my agar. And now make, in the similar fashion, make control plate also, which is not having your compound. And then you incubate the plate. Now data analysis. See, this is plain agar. There is no XYZ compound in it. You see all the microorganisms have grown. Okay. And this is agar with your XYZ compound. You see the one I have marked in circles, there is diminished or very less growth. That means there is some activity here. And this was tested at sub-inhibitory concentration. That means the microorganism which does not have, which has the genes, have grown. But the microorganism which does not have that particular gene, which is your mode of action, has not grown. And that's why it is inhibited. Now, what you do is try and make a list of genes. Now, basically with this library, you get which genes are placed in which order. So you try to find out which was this gene, maybe like from this, it was sixth row and I guess eighth column. So sixth row, eighth column, which was the gene. So you make all the list of genes and you enlist them. Then you confirm it by broth assay or spot assay. Like I now made, this is an example that I have created. I have this many number of genes that I screened out from my result, and I made again, I tested these genes just to confirm whether there is diminishing reaction. You can see for 8 ppm, there was no reaction. There was no diminishing effect. But for 10 ppm, there was diminishing effect. So I confirmed that, okay, these are the mutants that I have where my compound is active, even at sub-inhibitory concentration. Now you make a list and keep this list handy and use it in gene ontology tool. Gene ontology tool are available online. There are large number of gene ontology tool. What I used was Gorilla, Saccharomyces genome data, and Gene Mania. These are three which is used for fungus. You can even use it, I guess Gorilla can be used for a number of species. So you just have the box I have marked in red. You can just put all the list of your genes inside and just say go. There is a caption below. Go term analysis or search enrichment analysis. You just have to click on it and it gives you all the information. And it gives you an information that which molecular function can be your target. So like for the genes I had screened out, it is transmembrane transportation activity. That means there is something happening with the transportation inside the cell. Or which component of the cell it has inhibited. So my XY compound has inhibited maybe the cytoplasm, some components in cytoplasm, some components in membrane. So some of them are related to endoplasmic reticulum, some with mitochondria. So from this, I am getting an idea that, okay, mitochondria can be mode of action. But for this, I have to confirm it. So I will run different confirmatory tests just to confirm, oh, mitochondria, I can see in this. Maybe I do some mitochondrial potential activity or some mitochondrial test. Agree? So this particular software will give you hints that your possible mechanism is related to this. Now, what all you can do with gene ontology tool? You can not only select many microorganisms, like if I told you, if you're not using Saccharomyces cerevisiae here, maybe you are testing some cell line. You can choose Homo sapien and check for cell line. There are deleted mutants for cell lines also. So you can even choose functions. What I want to know what process my XYZ is inhibiting, or maybe what function it is inhibiting, or where this XYZ is acting on. So if you want to know the process, click on process. If you want to know the function, click on function. If you want to know which component it is inhibiting, like I told mitochondria, you can click on mitochondria, or you can get the analysis of all. The next is gene ontology. Also give you an example explanation wherein, say if I am searching for SERVCA ERG3 gene, and if the ERG3 gene is also in human body, then my compound can be toxic because it is also acting against fungus and also acting against human cells. So it also gives overlapping genes. That means if you have these set of genes, maybe two or three is overlapping with humans. So you can even find toxicity of your compounds. And the next is it can give you advanced parameter. That is, it can give you P values for which is the most active process, because it's not necessary. One compound can have a lot many mode of actions. So if you want to know what is the prime mode of action, so you can have P values. And the software also gives you a process through which these can happen. So it's a likely, but you have to go on confirmatory test to validate the same. So this is how you know mode of action of a compound. When you have absolutely no idea what the target can be. If you have further more questions, I'm open for questions. If you want to know more, you can just email me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mrunal. Now the question is open for question and answer session, as Mrunal had also said. So there are some questions, Dr. Mrunal. They have been posted in the chat box. I'll help you with the questions. So due to time constraint, we'll have a few questions only. So am I audible to you, Dr. Mrunal? Hello? Am I audible to you, Dr. Mrunal? Am I audible to you?
Yes, you're audible.
Due to the time constraint, I'm going to take only few questions. One question that is asked by Mr. Mahendra Trivedi, that as we know, coronavirus have high mutation property. So if we prepare vaccine and due to fast mutation, if this virus will create resistance for the vaccine, what do you think what will happen?
This is likely to happen when there is, see, resistance are of 2-3 types. You have acquired resistance, you have natural resistance. So if it is acquired resistant, definitely it would be much later. But it is an inbuilt resistant, then vaccines may, but then it will be when they are testing. Of course, it's not that you run just one test and you confirm that the vaccine is working. You have to run n number of tests upon n number of species and with n number of possibilities. So if there is inbuilt mutation, yes, the vaccine will fail. But if there is no inbuilt mutation, there is acquired mutation. Acquired means you are giving, and then after some time, the vaccine are getting acquired to the, like they are storing a knowledge. Then further it is maybe after years it can acquire resistance. But yeah, if it is inbuilt mutation, I'm sure during testing only they will get to know about this.
Next question, it's by Dr. V. Karunasri. When we are working with plant extracts, how should we select the starting concentration for antimicrobial evaluation?
Oh, good question. When you are selecting plant extract, I'm sure you know the concentration of your compound. Try and know the compound. Usually what we do is we dry the compounds and then we try to quantify the purity of the compounds. Based upon the purity of your compound, you prepare the concentrations. So, but in case if you're not able to dry your compounds, you should at least know the amount which is already available in the solvent. You can actually do a lot of tests to identify how much is your extract. Definitely, I'm not an expert of pharmacognosy, but I'm sure that when you extract something, you know how much is being extracted. So you can just make dilutions of it and then go about the handling. There are guidelines wherein you can actually know the potency of the compound, and from potency, you can calculate how to prepare the concentration.
Just one more question. Mr. Akshay Krishnan have asked that is epsilometry test cost effective or expensive?
These are basically, it is expensive basically, but I would say that more than concentrating on expensiveness, I would say that, you know, you can only test the known antimicrobial concentration because they are prepared by a company, but they're fast. The thing is, you don't have to, you know, bore it, soak it or anything. You just have to place it on the disc. But yeah, in case of other techniques like agar dilution, I would say it is expensive.
One more question by P. Muniswaran. How much time is required for MIC test? 1 or 2 days? What would be the time duration?
This may vary upon what microbe are you testing. Like bacteria's yeast, it is usually 24 hours, 48 hours. But if you're going for Aspergillus is filamentous fungus. Aspergillus takes 7 days to grow. So the MIC is visible only at 6th or 7th day. So it typically depends upon what microbes you are testing.
One more question by Isha Dangi, that is there a known case of using vaccine adjuvant separately to develop the long-term immunity?
I think there are many in clinical trials which are being tested to, prolong, this is a problem when you come with cases of HIV. So now there are a lot of combination therapy which are going on when you have antimicrobial agent with the immune modulators, and they are still in clinical trials. Yes, they are being tested.
For answering the questions. Actually, there are a number of questions, but due to time constraint, we had cut it short. So one instruction is there for the participants. Kindly fill the feedback form correctly, because the name and the name of your institute that you'll put into the feedback feedback link will appear as it is on your e-certificate. So if you make a mistake there, the same will be reflected on your e-certificate. So please make sure you fill your feedback form very correctly. So thank you, Dr. Mrunal.
Thank you.
So due to the short of time we are running, so that is why I have to close the Q&A session fast. One more thing that I want to share with the participants, that we are looking for the same response that we have received for this webinar, for the upcoming webinars. Since we are conducting a webinar series, there are a number of webinars that are coming. You can find out the details of upcoming webinars on our website, www.hrpatelpharmacy.co.in. There, the webinar details are being available as soon as possible. Now it's time for the vote of thanks. So it's my privilege to propose the vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to thank our speaker, Dr. Mrunal Patil. Thank you very much, Mrunal, for accepting our invitation and taking out time from your busy schedule, as we are aware that you're working there and you're busy with your tests. So thank you for giving your time. We want to say that HR Piper family is proud of you, as you are our alumni, and we wish you all the success for your future endeavor.
Thank you.
First of First and foremost, the organizing committee is also thankful to all of you for your overwhelming response. We got about 1,375 registrations in just 2 days, so which consisted of participants from different states of India like Sikkim, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Kerala, Odisha, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, and Jammu and Kashmir. Not only from within the country, but we also got enthusiastic response from countries like Nepal, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, and Nigeria. So we are very much thankful to all the participants, and we expect the same cooperation in coming webinars. We are also thankful to the management of our institute for providing us with the facilities and opportunity to conduct such intellectual feast. We are also thankful to our beloved principal, Dr. Bari sir, for always motivating us in conducting such programs for the benefit of the students and our participants. We are thankful to all the staff members of our college for their wholehearted support. We also take this opportunity to thank all those people who have directly and indirectly contributed in smooth conduction of this event. So thank you one and all. So I hope that if the participants are having any query, so Dr. Muna has already shared her email ID on the last slide. You can contact her. For any issues from our end, so I'm providing you an email ID in the chat box. So if you are having any query related to your certificate or any other issue, then you can contact me at pi.patil@hrpatilpharmacy.co.in. I'm sharing the email ID in the chat box. You can share your query on my email ID. Thank you very much. Now, with the kind permission of our principal sir, I declare the program is over. Feedback link is being provided to the participants. We hope that participants will fill it properly. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Nair. Yes. Sir, over to you, Dr. Baris. Hello, sir, over to you, sir. Hello, Dr. Bari, sir. Over to you, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir, we are able to hear.
Thank you very much, Mrunal, for your nice lecture. And I think all the participants have benefited of this subject, and they really know the depth of that antimicrobial action, mode of action, and with their activities also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for providing us this opportunity. I hope it was less time, but I think I could just give a gist of it, and right. I'm happy to help in future. No problems.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Declare the program is over. Thank you very much. We will end the meeting. Thank you.